We are a signal processing group back in India. I belong to the name is a science institute, but it is as much engineering as science also in this institute. And I'm a faculty. I'm a professor belonging to communication engineering department. And we have a small group of about 10 students working in signal processing problems as applicable to speech. And we have added music. Basically, our strength is understanding of speech signals. But I think I'll try to get across through today's seminar also why is it that music and speech should be put side by side? Okay, let me see if that is my that's my agenda in some sense. So I would like to talk about stochastic approaches. I mean, this is a small amount of work, small piece of work that we have started. Only a few years ago, and we are still quite young in this, unlike the group here which has worked in music technology for a long time. And so I'm happy to get your criticism, comments, any suggestions would be welcome. So the music that I would like to deal with for today's discussion of this stochastic modeling. I mean, as I said, stochastic modeling is for those of you who are not may not be hardcore ECE engineers. You may be artists. You may be music enthusiasts. Is mathematical models that are used for observing. For observing complex structures in the data that we measure. It's not a very simple definition I'm giving. For example, genetic sequences is also being looked at through stochastic models. There is a lot of data. I mean, one can do a lot of biology of blood samples or something, and then one can see, hey, what is the structure in this that is not apparently visible? So for such things, one can begin with statistical approaches. Some of the simplest statistical approaches are looking at mean and variance. And of course, we have figured out much more detailed, more complex, more involved methods of handling data and looking for structures in that. So in some sense, computer scientists have called this as data mining. You know how data mining, et cetera, is very important in computer science and Google search and et cetera, you may know. But these are little more. I mean, it is neither data mining nor is it simple statistics of mean and variance, but it's somewhere in between to see structures that are relevant to your perception. I mean, we have some notion of it. It's not that we don't know anything about it like a genetic sequence, but not that we can cross-check the meaning of it after you have done this data mining in a text data, but it's a different type of a structure mining, you may call it that. So music and speech signals are common, have this common trait of we as human beings see a lot of meaning in it. Meaning, definitely what it means in speech is obvious to you. Okay? Speech has a lot of meaning, otherwise it's not a speech at all. Music has a lot more feelings. Okay? Let's call meaning as feeling. Okay? Let's just call just for the sake of communication. And so if we attach meanings, if we attach feelings to meanings, then we can see that these both these signals are extremely important and highly evolved by human beings, actually. This is a highly evolved scheme of how many different types of languages exist in the world, how many different types of speeches exist in the world. We have evolved to use it, but we know so little of it, actually. Okay? So engineering disciplines are trying to grapple with some of them for various different applications. So for example, in speech, we have worried about source coding. How do we compress this speech with as little bandwidth as possible? Similarly, how do we compress music? That has been looked at. I'm just giving this few minutes of introduction so that if there is a community who is not very much into technology of these subjects, you get motivated. So these are the technologies that have been addressed from a purely engineering point of view. But speech recognition, when it comes to speech recognition particularly, and this kind of music analysis that some of you are doing, there is music technology aspects wherein you don't go so much into the meaning of it. But there are certain technological aspects wherein we have to go to the meaning of it. Like in speech recognition, what you say, I have to understand, or a computer has to understand what you said. That is where speech recognition is. We have lots of difficulties still in these specific problems where we have to go from signal to meaning. Okay? That is still a bigger challenge. So wherein signal processing, language modeling, and then In some sense, semantic modeling is also very important. So these are all multiple levels of engineering that still are evolving, and they are fairly good challenges, both from a scientific point of view as well as from a technology point of view. So please take that short introduction. And we have chosen here, I'm talking of in our group and this problem, classical music, because there is less freedom in it. Okay, we'll talk of freedom. Unlike, there are many other forms of music, it's just an open ocean. Okay, if you take all types of languages, etc. Instead, if you take take English speech as spoken by Britishers, well spoken according to the grammar, etc. So that is a very structured speech. So to begin with, that is the kind of a speech research or speech processing that one would do. Similarly, if I would draw an analogy, for me, Indian classical music is very structured. There is a certain rigor of learning it, certain rigor of playing it, with a certain permitted freedom of performance, and hence it is a little smaller problem to deal with. But whereas the kind of projects that you are trying to deal with, the world music, are open-ended, there are many more challenges in that end. So with that context, here are a few pictures. I mean, maybe we'll come back to these pictures if we have time. So for example, these are all different types of performances of Indian classical music. I think let me move on a little further and then come back to this picture if there is time. I would say this Indian classical music is an art form. Actually, it's considered as an art because there is a certain structure to that. Okay, creativity and art are somewhat slightly different words. Don't pin me down. I'm still an engineer. I have not become a humanities professor yet. So if you somehow believe, I will believe that you understand what is the difference between creativity and art. You know, creativity is much more open-ended. Art is little more structured, and if others can see art in what you do, then it is artistic. I mean, it has creativity in art. So let me just call this as, this is a term that is used by one of the Hindustani vocalists. She calls classical music, classical somehow everything old is not art music, but certain forms of classical renderings is art music. So let's call it as art music. For engineering purposes, we can call this as art music, semi-art music, film music, that type of a classification. Okay, that's another type of a terminology that one can bring in. So this has evolved over many centuries, and there is a relationship to vocal music, instrumental music, and also dance form. So there is this ancient epic documents in India, such as this Bharatas Natya Shastra, which have been put down. By the way, in my talk, I will have to use many Indian terms, and I'm not very well versed in translating them to the English or Western music context. So I will appeal to you to see as much meaning as you can see, but go forward and see, maybe you should refer to Wikipedia or some other context to be able to appreciate the full meaning of some of the terms actually. Okay, let me not get into defining each of them very accurately, and then I will not progress further into my engineering problem at all. My goal is to handle the engineering problem behind this. So these put together are referred to as the Sangeet, and the dance form is also an important component. So I can use this. So this is important. There is a term rasa here. This is the feeling. This is the bhava. You know, this creates certain emotional reaction or induces certain emotion in you, and that's the purpose of most music. Okay, this is what is considered as very important, and that takes us to one of the points that I want to bring in somewhere by the end of this talk, that we will have to touch something of cognition. Okay, to be able to fully appreciate the music and speech analogy, as well as to solve some of the problems also, to be able to concretely answer some of the deep questions in speech and music. Okay, so sort of basic structure, if you want to bring out the functionality of instruments, there is this rhythm. Rhythm is the thala, that's the word, and melody is the raga. So the drone is the background instrument that is used, such that the variable tonality, I mean the shadja is the fundamental note with which the singer is, the vocalist is trying to render the piece, render the musical piece, that reference point, the reference note is what is fixed by this the drone tanpura. It's an aid for the vocalist to, when he goes away in the rendering of the raga and then comes back, there is a certain reference, as well as there are accompanying instruments or accompanying singers who will also keep reference to that, the bass note. Okay, as a quick contrast, there are fixed frequencies that you people use in, I believe, in Western music. I'm neither a Western music expert nor an Indian music expert. I'm still an engineer. So I'm also a student as far as music terminology, everything is concerned. So take it with that context. I mean, if there are errors in what I say, please correct it online. So a drone is an instrument that is used more for reference of keeping this this basic shadja. Okay. What is important is that there is a single, it is not an orchestral music that we are talking about of many people and a conductor. Here the lead artist becomes in some sense a conductor. Okay. So there is the lead artist who is for the concert, for the art music concert, most important. He or she is choosing the shadja in which the person is going to sing or comfortable. And then the other accompaniment is very minimum. There's usually a side instrument and another percussionist. Sometimes, if you go back to the previous figures, you can see that there are two percussionists and there is sometimes another vocal support. There are slight variations of this concert. Okay. The Shruti is what is the tonality that we fix the basic note and the successive notes. This slide will take a lot of time if I spend time. This, in one slide, we have tried to capture here of how a music concert would go on. Okay, I can just generally go through this. I don't want to, I can end up spending a lot of time on this. This is a typical Carnatic music concert structure. Okay, you can see that there is a lot of structure in not just one raga, but in the rendering of that evening program. So that evening program would be about 2 to 3 hours, and it's referred to as a kacheri. And what is important is that most of Carnatic music is bhakti pradana. Bhakti is the easiest word for me. It's a very loaded word and it's a very cultural word. I could say at the least it's devotion. So you can even say it a devotional music. There is more to this. In Indian philosophy, and music is very closely interwoven with the culture and the philosophy of a community. Definitely that, I'm sure, obviously you will all appreciate, and Indian classical music is no exception to that. And there is a lot of veneration, you wouldn't say, not only admiration, veneration, if you know the word. Veneration is when you look upon with a lot of respect. Okay, so if there is a musician, he is highly respected, especially classical music performers. He is not just an artist. He is much more than an artist. That much more than an artist happens because of that bhakti pradhana. Okay, so Carnatic music is usually for getting across the rasa or the bhava with the theme of certain devotion to certain god or certain religious aspect. Okay, so there is that linkage, but it is in contrast to that, the Hindustani music, the other form of art music in India, is more, I would say, it is more recreational, and there is not so much bhakti and God and religion relationship to that. Okay, that's one broad differentiation. So usually it begins with, for example, this, that bhakti invocation to Lord Ganesha. Lord Ganesha is the god of the one who helps in getting over hurdles in your way. So usually many things in Hinduism, you begin with a small prayer, or at least remembering the Lord Ganesha. Many, many people even wear the symbol of that. He's the elephant god that you will see. Okay. So also here you see, in most Carnatic music concerts, it begins with a certain invocation. It also begins with a certain, conclusion called Mangalam. You again pray God to say that, hey, it all went well. Please help us out, not only for for the well-being of myself, for the well-being of everybody around me. You know, that's the kind of a broad philosophical approach that exists in this form of music. The context is important. So all this context is important. I don't want to just, finally we will pin it down to certain engineering problems. But I think we are touching a medium here, or a data, if you call it data, and for engineers, any measurement is data. So a data here which has got lot more meaning behind it, a lot more veneration or bhakti, everything. So I'm very cautious. Usually in knowledge itself, it's our Hindu culture to say that you should go with humility to knowledge. That's our vidyarthi. Now we should seek knowledge. I mean, there is a lot of veneration to education, learning, etc. In these forms of art, it is even more. So please keep that background, and it's not that it is essential for you to follow what I'm going to talk, but that context is important. In between are these, you can see that, for example, a raga will have in between several pieces, and each one of them would be something like 10 minutes of rendering. So, for example, this begins in one raga, there's another invocation, another raga, so 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So, for example, the main piece here, this is called Ragam Thanam Pallavi. So in here, all the technicalities of the artist's capability. The technicality is different from bhava. So every artist himself or herself recognizes that aspect. Okay? How much is the bhava important here? How much is the technicality important here? Even the dancer, but the Bharatanatyam dancer, she will perform a lot of pieces in which there is bhava that is important. Maybe mother's love towards child, or somebody, Raudravatara, a goddess who is killing a demon. All these bhavanas are brought out, but there is always another piece in which the pure technicality of the dance form is also brought out. Okay, fast movements and tough movements and, juxtaposing very odd phrases. So all these kinds of things exist even in music, and that is what many a times are shown up in a main piece that happens in the middle. And here itself is another component to the, in fact, there is a certain individuality that is recognized among the side instruments also. So for example, for the percussionist, there is a position here, this is called Taniyavartanam. Here the main artist withdraws, and he or she will just keep quiet and allow the percussionist himself or herself to expand on his view of that piece. So it's in some sense a group performance as well as an individual performance for them to come up with. So these are sort of well put down conventions, let's call it as. It's a conventions, and people enjoy. I mean, for example, some people, it's very common in South India that some people don't like so much the percussionist's expansion, and they just walk away when that is happening. It's not so good, but it's common, you will see. Some other people who wait for this to happen, actually, they wait, concentrate on the Taniyavartanam itself. And so these are some cultural, habitual things in the context of Carnatic music. So this is, for example, Hindustani music, they sing for much longer than these concerts. There it is not so many ragas, here it's 5, 6, 7, or sometimes the last piece. Many a times for those light music interested people, this is a lot of variety here. So many, many small pieces are rendered here. For example, I am one of those who likes many of these small pieces here. Okay, so there are certain different cultural aspects to a concert program like this. Hindustani music, I was saying that it lasts for 5, 6 hours, and sometimes the whole night. They begin at around 10 o'clock in the night, and until about early morning it goes on, and they render hardly some 2 or 3 pieces many a times. Okay, whereas here Carnatic music, you will see that there are many more pieces, but it is structured and packed in within about a few hours, couple of hours, and not longer than that. Okay, so what is a raga? I mean, I'm still in the introduction. I have not come to the crux of what we're talking about. I mean, my plan is to put across the few approaches in the literature on stochastic modeling that has been done, along with something that we did in our lab This was last year, end of last year, and presented at the WASPA conference. So I want to cover all of that. So let me see if I can go over to that. So here is a raga structure. These terms are important. Alap is pure notes. There is no percussionist here. So there is improvisation scope there. And sometimes singers skip the alap also. That's what is meant by saying optional. Lyrics. Lyrics are also important because they add to the emotion created by the raga bhava. Okay? The lyrics add to that. So lyrics are the ones which contain the semantic content in a different way. So you are talking about a specific god or a specific flower or a specific situation like that. Okay? So lyrics will come in the form of what is called Pallavi, Anupallavi, Charana. Okay? So this is a small initial stanza and then a supportive stanza, and then these are usually little longer than the Pallavis. So these Charanas keep repeating. This is a structure that comes because of the lyrics in the music piece. Okay? And the Pallavi, you can say that Charana, Pallavi, like that. Okay? So it is an alternation that happens. And people enjoy a lot the raga bhava, the mood that is created by the music and the lyrics actually. This combination is very important. In Hindustani music, the lyrics are not so important. For them, purely raga bhava. But in Carnatic music, the text and this go together, and there is a lot of creativity. People write lyrics for the particular raga, and the other way also. They take text and incorporate a raga into that. Okay, so all types of these combinations are considered as very, very creative. I think I might have said this already. Let's move on. Maybe I should just talk of Arohana and Avarohana. This is the set of notes. The set of notes that are in increasing order of pitch, and this is the set of notes in the decreasing order of pitch. So among the, I think here, this is a example that Aarti created for bringing out the context between the Indian terminology for notes and the Western terminology for the notes here. So you can see that there is a 12 note scale. It is not equitempered. So these are determined with certain specific ratios, and you will see in the literature what are those specific ratios, and there are some debates, people fight about it. I think let's not get into all of that. That's not the crucial aspect here. So you can identify these 12 notes in correspondence with those 12 notes, and that is one octave. Okay, one octave. And the use of, say, let's say I use this, so that is what is a Kalyani. So we use this. So omitting these notes, that is characteristic of Kalyani. Okay, Kalyani is a raga, it's a name to a raga. Even the naming of ragas, there are many ragas. There is a certain beauty of the musicology of art music, Carnatic music. And I don't want to get into that. It's almost like the grammar of a particular language. Do we have to worry about the grammar of the language, or how we speak the language? See, that's the difference. See, what we speak is it will determine the grammar. So it's not that all of us speak with the perfect grammar. Similarly, music also, there is a certain grammar, but how you render that finally becomes the one that communicates the bhava. Okay, so in that sense, arguments or discussions confining only to the musicology or the grammar of music is less important. I mean, we as engineers have to deal with data. Okay, as data, what is it that we really see on the ground? This is the speech. We call it even in speech processing, we call it found speech. Get the speech as spoken in the street. What can you see the meaning around it? Not the speech that is spoken by a lecturer or a phonetician, like that. So that the same is true with music. So this kind of analogy of speech and music is teaching us quite a lot. So these are three different ragas: Karahara Priya, Shanmuga Priya. So you can see that there's a change of. So instead of this particular ma, another ma is introduced here. Okay. So the choice of this is called the Arohana, and in the Avarohana, In fact, Arohana Avarohana structure we are not talked of here. Selection of particular ragas in the scale here. And in fact, the method that we are talking about for raga identification in the end, the main body of our work is more in the recognition of the shadja itself. How do we recognize this? Okay, that is where the key component of our work is. But once we do that, we tend to show that, okay, if I know that it is this particular ri, ga and ma that is significant in this particular rendering, then I can say it is Kalyani. So this mapping of this broad structure to Kalyani is the simple aspect. Okay, you can say that it is a structured mapping. Okay, so we recognize with prior knowledge the structure of the raga and so why stochastic models? I think I am coming into a bit of engineering now here. So as I said, anything that has a lot of variability, anything that has a lot of variability, like in speech or like in atmospheric modeling, we can't say that even temperature at this spot is not the same as the temperature at that spot, although we can talk of an average of the room temperature. Okay, so whenever there is a variability and we have to deal with variability, stochastic models are very useful. And what are the variabilities that come into music? People in fact question as to, are we right at all to use stochastic models? For example, this was registered in speech processing. Grammar, nobody viewed it as stochastic model. They thought it's a deterministic grammar, a well laid out set of rules as to how to form sentences out of words. But the evolution of the speech processing research proved the other way. Yes, that may be true, but in the speech that we speak, we are not that strict in following those rules. So when we speak with a lot of variability, we better apply some other tools and some other methodology for deciphering how I am speaking or what meaning I might have communicated. So I mean, many sentences that I speak, I may not speak perfectly grammatical sentences at all, but still there is some structure. So this via media of seeing certain deterministic structure as well as certain variability on this deterministic structure is the crux of the problem. Okay, it is not that it is totally random, structureless data. There is structure, but that structure has variability. I mean, as I speak, as you speak, as some other context, there is variability. What do I do with that variability? So deterministic algorithms as used in computer science, like what is a deterministic algorithm? A sorting algorithm is a deterministic algorithm. So deterministic algorithms may not yield us always the required result. So many a times building in the stochastic models has helped a lot. In the evidence comes from, I mean, it's not a proof that my method will always work, but all I'm saying is that it is this method that has worked to some extent in handling information rich signals such as speech signals. So therefore, it is likely that we can apply such similar techniques in the music also. That's the kind of a hypothesis we are going with. So what are the variabilities? I mean, as I said here, pitch estimation inaccuracies because of certain techniques, shadja choice. Every singer uses a different shadja. Even he begins tomorrow, he comes same person, but tomorrow he may not sing with the same bass note. Okay, so he may choose a different shadja. So choice of swaras, different swaras for different ragas. So choice of there is a influence of sahitya. That sahitya is the lyrics or the text. So let's just take it as anbhava, of course. I mean, how do we communicate bhava out of certain small nuances of variations of swaras are also very important. Okay, so there is a certain, it is not only just variability of one type, variability to different zooming in. Not at very fine level, of course, if you zoom in too much, there is always too much variability. So at different levels, there are different variabilities. So to take care of this, we have to develop clever algorithms. I think that is where I would say that is my starting point as a researcher. As an engineering researcher, my starting point is, how do I handle these variabilities at different levels? Okay, and what tools do I have? How can I be making sure that how much error am I making at every stage, and how are they propagating into different stages? This is my statement of an engineering statement of the problem. Okay, I didn't want to say this in the beginning because it will take all the rasa and bhava out of music. Okay, it's useless. So, but let's respect that aspect and still go ahead with our engineering. So what are the approaches? I don't know, I would like to just, there are three or four papers. Yeah, let me see if I can run through. So one of the early works, I mean, we didn't do very exhaustive search in the literature, but from whatever we have seen, this is the work of mostly Ranjani. I mean, my first author, as you saw here, a lot of work is by Ranjani, and the other student is a master student. She's Aarti, and they're both, I'm their guide. So it's our work. So from whatever we have seen, this is a sort of one of the early efforts for raga identification, you see, in the context of classical music, and raga identification is what we are trying to look at. So basically they are looking at manual shadja. Okay, it's not, so there is this kind of a semi-automatic. In contrast to what we are aiming at is a fully automatic method of identifying shadja. there is a HMM that is being used here. That is what is very attractive. It looks very attractive to say that. In fact, HMMs are hidden Markov models. They are doubly stochastic models which are extremely successful and fantastic for speech decoding. So it's very natural that any engineering student will say, I should be able to apply that somewhere else. So HMMs are being used in many other problems also, many, many different problems. So in many, for genetic sequences or some other image recognition, face recognition, many, many different contexts, HMMs are being used. So it's interesting to, so one gets attracted towards that also. But what has happened here, I want to go a little fast in criticizing the literature and bringing our work to the current situation, is that basically they use emission probabilities here. I mean, if you don't know anything of HMMs, my comment will not make much sense. The HMM has one layer of Markov model, which is a state transition probability. And these are states are called latent variables in mathematics. These are abstract variables or structures that we discover through a stochastic formulation. I mean, it is not that it exists in the data that we see, but we tend to decompose an observed data out of some hidden structures in it. Okay. Now, the hidden structures are then imposition of the model that we have come up with. Okay, that is why it's called a hidden Markov model. The Markov probability, Markov is the probability of event A at time t, depending upon certain event at time t minus 1, just behind one memory. Okay, so if you just look at it as what is the probability of something happening followed by another thing, like lightning and thunder, what is the probability of lightning followed by thunder, or if you say sunshine followed by rainbow, you know, it's not that it's always. So certain sequences are lower probability, certain sequences are higher probability, and these sequences and these probabilities are learned automatically from the data. That's the point that you should remember. It's not that we figure it out, but we see that if we impose this structure, we can come up with algorithms. This is the estimation maximization algorithm. I hope some of you are engineering students and know about stochastic models. Okay, is all of you or majority of them know? Okay. So can I assume that you all know GMMs and HMMs, Gaussian mixture models and hidden Markov models? Okay, that's what is required for the discussion today. So that's where we are heading. So I'm criticizing the particular HMM approach of this 2003, wherein they use this state conditioned observation probability as binary variables. So the states become, I think I'll not drag it too much. The states are chosen to be 36 of them. Where did this 36 come from? 12 note positions and 3 octaves. Most vocalists don't go beyond this. Even vocalists and flute, bamboo flute that I'm talking about, they do not go beyond 3 octaves. Sometimes violinists can go little wider, etc. But 3 octaves is a fairly good engineering boundary that we can fix for analyzing a lot of variety of music. Okay, so they fix the 36 states there, 12 per octave, and then this state became now a note position, and this, because the binary emission probability being a 0 or a 1, it's almost like a transcription. It's almost like a Markov model. It is not a hidden Markov model. There is nothing much hidden in this because of this binary aspect that has come in there. Okay, so we tend to think that it's a very restricted use of the powerful model. HMM is a very powerful model, but it's the usage is very restricted here. And finally, their performance is only upon some two ragas of 15 renderings. So it's a small database. This is also an important thing because in all engineering problems that we're talking about, of going from data to semantics, how much variety of data have I handled to say that my stochastic model is still effective of that variability? If I take a little data, there is very little variability. If I take a large amount of data, there is a lot of variability. Data as found in the real life. That's what we call as real data. Okay. Going forward, there's another one HMM based approach. this is from another group in India. they use a raga identification similar to the first paper that we talked about, and they confine to 12 states here, once again binary emission probability, and they report very good accuracy. But because of this manual Shadja identification, the nodes become very rigid, very 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 successful for them. Okay, it is not it is a part of the problem, I would say. This is like symbol mapping. Instead of handling speech, you are handling text. So from speech to text, if somebody has given the text, can you say that it is English or whether it is French or something like that? Okay. From spoken speech to recognizing whether it is English or French is much harder than given the text to go to whether it is English or French. Okay. By the way, we handle all those problems, and in fact, the varieties of problems that we have handled in speech processing makes us very fertile for us to handle music problems also. I mean, I would say that as a researcher. I think I'll skip and go forward to what. Let me see if I can say it. In text processing, there is an approach wherein they would like to decompose a given text into its semantic content. Okay? By reading a paragraph, can you say that it's a political science paragraph, or can you say that it's something about Spain, or is it something about some medicine? So these are some semantic meanings that we attach out of reading certain amount of text. So these are very high-level inference that you have drawn, similar to music. Music, you heard it, many notes for a certain duration, then you realize that, it is Karahara Priya, or this is Kalyani, something. I mean, you need certain structures, and you have analyzed certain structures, and then you get the feeling. So, like in semantics of the document that you are dealing with, this is called latent component analysis. So there are both the deterministic as well as the stochastic methods of decomposing a given document into, this is 50% political, 30% medical, 10% philosophical. You know, one can get this kind of a decomposition out of document analysis. These are very important for classifications of millions of documents that exist actually, and then giving you an alert for searching these databases and things like that. So latent component analysis is another very, very powerful, last about 15 years. I mean, this is a technique that has come to popularity recently. And this group again, this is the Anna University group, Sridhar et al., they have tried to apply this latent Dirichlet allocation, Dirichlet distribution in a specific form of stochastic distribution, that they have applied for raga identification. The special thing is that instead of taking one swara at a time, they are taking four successive nodes, and then trying to treat them as vectors and trying to do a decomposition. They have tried to use a supervised framework wherein data of known raga is given, and from that, based upon that, you learn the weight factors for the Dirichlet distribution, and then try and check it out as to what performance you got for unknown data. Okay. But however, the
the questions of Sharjah unification still remain in many of these So the main question that we would like to ask is, can we do this Swara and Sharjah unification automatically, and then could we go forward from there? Okay. So what do we know about Sharjah? Sharjah is always present irrespective of the raga, okay, unlike other notes. So Sharjah is the basic C note of the Sahana. And it's also referred to as an achara swara. I mean, it doesn't change, it should not modify the sa and the pa and the sa again. Those are the ones which are very least variation actually. So Sharjah must have least variation across octaves for a mode in pitch density function. So I will go into some examples and see what is it that we're doing here. Okay. Here is a density function of pitch estimation of a particular raga, Karaharpriya, Karaharpriya raga by D.K. Patamar. So we are considering, this is the initial work, so we are taking the easiest approach of taking the alap where there is no, maybe this drone. The drone is there but no percussion, so our pitch estimation should be as easy as possible. So it is even based upon Pratt, so Pratt uses a pitch estimate. One can get more clever into this and make it much better. But what we are trying to show here is that the highest probability note is not necessarily the Sharjah. That's the point we are trying to make here. So we need to do something else. This is the distribution of the pitch straight away. And this is a histogram method actually. Okay. So how do we estimate this kind of probability density function of pitch distribution itself? Is a small problem. It's not a big problem, but it's a small problem. So one can look at if you use a Poisson window method, how much to use for averaging, etc. Problem issues come in. But some kind of a next approach that we're talking about, which tells us about the separation between the nodes. So if we take care of proper engineering of knowing the separation between the nodes, this is a log scale by the way. It's not that it's a log scale as in most music scales. So, depending upon the separation between the nodes and certain knowledge about that variability, this variability is also important. So, we should be able to construct good methods of estimating a probability density function out of this pitch distribution. So, how do we take care of Sharjah identification? These are all the nodes that exist, but among these nodes, which one is the Sharjah? Is the question that we are asking. So Ranjini came up with some methods here. she went with the hypothesis that let us take each peak, all the peaks, as possible Sharjahs. Okay. So she modeled a Gaussian and then Gaussian mixture model. So here is, so there are 36. This is the assumption or the restriction that we have put. This is not at all, it's not much of a restriction. 3 octaves and 12 notes per octave representation, and we have not determined the ratios between the notes yet. Okay, we are not yet. So it is just to identify which one is the Sharjah. So after getting the sa, then we can talk about ratios that either based upon prior knowledge, that is one way of determining the scale, or you can even determine a scale as meant for that particular singer. It may be that is the That's a debate in certain types of styles of music actually, even in art music. They say that this particular ratio is not correct as you are using it. What I do is better than what you are doing. Now this kind of a debate exists. So that can be taken care of in the next stage. But as such, right now in Sharjah identification, we just began with a mixture Gaussian model like this. Each is a Gaussian here of the random variable, which is a pitch estimation. It's a scalar value. So it's a one-dimensional Gaussian distribution with a certain mean and a variance. And these are the mixture components. The I's are the mixture components going from 1 to 36. Okay. So what did we do? So if you simply put a Gaussian onto that, so this is what we ended up with. So what she is trying to show here is that a 36 mixture GMM will not necessarily put the Gaussians at at the required places. Okay? Wherever there is a higher probability portion of the density function, there are more mixture components that are put such that it is fitted better. So this is a problem, this is an EM algorithm, estimate maximization algorithm. So to the data, we are fitting a model. So although this is a very respectable method of GMM model fitting to the distribution of pitch values, it's not necessarily well informed. So getting the overall likelihood to be very high is not our only goal. So we have to make sure that these components, component mixture components that we have, really fall into the right place where we can see some meaning out of those mixture components. So this is a figure that illustrated that this kind of a liberal Gaussian mixture modeling is not the best. So what we came up with and is what we know from speech again, this is a semi-continuous Gaussian mixture model. Why it's called semi-continuous, it's a very funny term that is used by the speech researchers. It is neither a discrete probability mass function as used in probability theory, nor is it a continuous density function as the GMM would represent. Somewhere in between, hence it is called semi-continuous because the Gaussian positions are fixed here, but whereas its parameters are estimated. So how did the Gaussian positions are fixed here? Positions are fixed based upon the ratios. Okay, since the ratio structure is known, on the log scale it is like saying the formula place. Okay, so there's a slight variation of that. So since the positions are fixed, so it's like a grid actually. It's a grid of Gaussians, and you are trying to estimate which grid is most suitable, or the, which is the one that gives rise to the best likelihood fitting. Okay, maximum likelihood fitting. So as expected, moment we put the semi-continuous model, you can see that say there's a mixture that fits very well here, that falls into this node, this one here, and so thus these are all the little ones that rarely occur, and with a lot of variation also, you know, these are the ones that may come in between some gamakas and such positions, therefore they're not very well estimated. So they will not cause confusions with other nodes. Okay, the dominant nodes and the less dominant nodes are not mixed up now. So they are sort of, they got separated out because of the choice of the semi-continuous mixture model. Okay. So in some sense, prior knowledge is influencing better stochastic modeling here. Okay. Once we fit this model, we still don't know where the Shatja is, which is the sub, which is the basic C node. So we come up with certain measures of she proposed about 4 or 5 different measures, and they are all related. There's nothing very mysterious in this, very simple. This is the variance to the weight, the weight to the variance. Weight is nothing but the area under each Gaussian. Okay, if you integrate it under the Gaussian curve, that is the total weight of a mixture model. The alpha is the weights. The sigmas are the variance. So we are looking for that Shatja. So what should be the character of that Shatja? So we are looking for that Shatja which has got minimum variance as well as maximum weightage. This weightage is in the denominator. So a combination of minimum variance and maximum weightage is viewed as a possible candidate for Shatja. And she tried different combinations, and also there is one more thing here. We are not only looking for the Shatja. If Shatja is fixed, its ratio 1.5, the pa, the sa and the pa, c and the ga, is it g? Pa. So that is also very, very achalas for us. It is fairly rigid. And the next octave. So we take all the three. So S0 is the base node, and S plus is the other. The octave was Shatja, and the pa is the one in the middle one. So the C and the G and the C plus. The C higher. So considering all three of them, so you can do this is what typical of our engineering. After I take arithmetic mean and optometric mean, and you can do all those theories. She found out that I think it is this one that gave the best performance. So even this gave the best among these 5 alternatives, and the best itself is hardly some 87% or so correct. It's still not 100%. Okay. But that was pretty good. pretty good for the size of the database that we handle. Okay, there are certain other comments that we are trying to make here. It is totally unsupervised. I think I would stress on this point that we wanted to explore, it is not even necessary to use Gaussian mixture models. In fact, we noticed, these are the things that engineers should notice. Even in the Raga variation, why should it be Gaussian? And in the variation of errors, after all it's a log scale. So the variation of errors that people will make, do they make errors to the our estimation algorithm or the singing style? Do they make more errors to the higher side or the lower side? So depending upon that, we can fit mixture models which are more asymmetric. So for example, I think she tried semi-continuous gamma mixture models. Okay. So this is something innovative, but she says that her performance gave about the similar score. So there is scope for, I mean, engineers to really explore things of this kind, and that's what I'm trying to suggest here. Anyway, our performance in this case is about the same. This is another interesting thing. Usually this pitch having and doubling is worrying quite a lot. There's a lot of work that is done at the pre-modeling stage to take care of these errors. They have algorithms to post-process these errors actually. Because of the natural way of we clubbing this higher octave as well as lower octave, these errors got taken care of in this stochastic modeling itself. So that was another sort of a side benefit that we got out of this shelter modeling problem. What are the limitations? Yes, the variable is 13% errors. This is the kind of, we had the estimation results. On an average, we got 88% here. And we have, of course, tested out only on Janney Ragas. We have not tested on Janney Ragas or on Janaka Ragas, that is Medakartha Ragas, wherein there is occurrence of all the 7 notes. If any of the, we consider the 12 note scale, the V1, V2 is an alternative. Okay, Ma1, Ma2 is an alternative actually. So wherever there is 7 nodes occurring in both the ascending scale as well as the descending scale, it's called a Janaka Raga, it's called the mother Raga. And there are exactly 72 of them. Okay, so this is called Medakartha Raga. Very musicology, you can go into, there are very good books and very easy. Those are the easy portions actually. I think for engineering, we should concentrate more on the data. Although we have begun with those ragas, those are the structures, okay? Pantura, Adishu, Kapriya, Haikambo. So you can see that all the 7 nodes are there, 3 plus 4 plus. So it's either G2 or G3 or R1, R2 or M1, M2 or P1, P2 or M3. So those are the choices that we have. Taking all these into consideration and totally about entrance is there in the VASPA paper. If I'm a little unclear, this is already about 1 year old paper, so therefore I forgot some numbers. You can take a look at VASPA paper. So I think we did about 70 or 80 ARMAPs of about 6 or 7 singers. And the number of ragas were not too many different. So we took number of ragas are this about 7 ragas. 7 ragas, right? And all were this Medakartha ragas. Okay? Anyway, so let's move on. From Shadja to Swara, so next so going to the Swaras is the easy part now because of the particular ratio that are available now. So from the Swaras, so depending upon whether it is R1 or R2, so one could, the kind of subset of ragas that we are differentiating is fairly easy. So it's more like raga verification. What we are saying is that, hey, which one is this raga? So how accurately have I estimated my R1, R2 difference, or Ma1, Ma2 difference, or Ma1, Ma2 difference? So that's the kind of work that we did here. So that performance, this performance is a subset of the performance of the correct Shadja identification. So we did not transmit the Shadja identification errors to the next case. No, we have not done that. So if you were to build, for example, HMM, I would be fond of looking at the whole thing together. So multi-layered stochastic model, and then to be able to do a joint maximization of the model learning as well as model. So here we perform something like an average of 91.5% identification. So we also noted down which nodes gave rise to confusion, and you can see that they are typically neighboring nodes. Yeah, so we tend to call this as unsupervised identification. This is a little bit of a debatable aspect. It is not that pattern recognition scheme has been learned based upon some labeled data. So in case for certain types of ragas where the structure is so deterministic, it will work for many more ragas. So you don't have to have a large amount of training data to build these models. That's the terminology that we are trying to use here as unsupervised. So of course, as I said, we have just based it upon the most primitive or the first step of pitch distribution model that we have taken. Of course, one can look at other higher order statistics of bigram probabilities, Kringgraf probabilities, and much more structured can be exploited for very good points. Okay. I think this is what we talked in another paper that we wrote of speech and music parallels. I think I already talked a little bit about it. I can quickly just make some comments that music is very emotion rich and speech is very information rich. My fond statement is that both speech and music takes us into the depths of human behavior. Okay, there's something about human behavior that is sort of compacted in speech and music of a certain person or a culture, I would say a group of people, small group. So in that sense, it is a highly evolved scheme, and touching some of those, I mean, if we never solve the speech decoding problem, we should not be too unhappy. Okay, if we can do it, it's good. You know, many man-made systems, I mean, we may never ever be able to predict the weather conditions perfectly. It's not made, it's so huge. Similar to that, I mean, I go with that humility to the observation of human produced data, that we may never ever be able to, because it's a question, it's a philosophical question, as some philosophers have posed. I'm trying to understand my own behavior. Human beings are trying to understand human deep behavior. Speech and music is one of those. These are well understood by psychologists, and if you read some of those papers, there are certain very specific, philosophical arguments as to how much can you understand by the mechanisms that your own cognition has provided. You are trying to understand your own cognition. At the most, I can utilize you, you can utilize me. I mean, that's the easy part. Or we can even utilize multiple agent type of thing. There may be a very great limitation of how many different types of questions can we ask. Our logic itself could be a limitation. This is the kind of a philosophical statement we can make. This is not to undermine. Engineers, we need not undermine that, oh, something very difficult, I couldn't touch it, I can't go to the moon. No. But he said long ago, I can't go to the moon, now we can go to the moon. So similarly, engineers, we don't want to be bogged down by this, but we can be just aware of it. So it would be beautiful to look at speech and music simultaneously, although we have not solved any greatly into speech problem. It's a little more mature, I would say, a little more, people have spent a few more decades understanding speech a little more. And I think I am ambitious of saying that probing the music signals in parallel a little more may help even speech research, vice versa. So we would like to benefit from both, because they are both very deep behaviors of same hearing system or the human cognition system. That's what I would say. This is Ranjani's word. I hope you understand that symbiotic existence, coexistence with certain complementary skills is symbiotic existence. So speech and music are symbionts to our brain. Okay. Invites meaningful comparison. So the comparison is meaningful, you see. It is there, we have to be intelligent to make the right comparisons actually. There is meaning in each one of them. In comparing them also, we should be careful as to which ones are comparable, which are not comparable. Okay. So I think that's why we are fond of saying that it is teaching us and taking towards a little more of cognition. I mean, I'm fond of saying that we will be able to use both signal processing and machine learning techniques, which are standard fields in engineering and computer science, right? So we can use tools from both of these areas to advance technology. And probably, I mean, we should look at the tools or the methodologies that are developed by psychologists. Psychologists have worked on cognition quite a lot. There's a lot of theory. I mean, like linguists have worked a lot in speech, but we have not utilized all those theories. Try to use some of it, some of the Chomsky and hierarchy, etc. We succeeded to some extent, then we had hard bouncing, so we gave up all that, then we have gone into stochastic models. Just because we have gotten into stochastic models and it's showing some success, we shouldn't say that this all is useless. No, no, no. It's one type of description. I mean, all theories have a certain place. We may not have converted it to a technology or, you know, a simple solution. So same thing applies to music understanding. We can use certain technology tools, but at the same time, the psychologist's contribution to the cognitive aspects of music and speech. In fact, when it comes to speech and music, the psychologists study them together. Actually, there's a lot of symbiotic thinking there. I feel as an academic, it's worth and interesting, and we hope to. Probably next time I come, I will talk some more about that if we have made any progress.